Right, good morning again, everyone. My name is Margaret Baguli, the Chair of the Conference's Standing Committee for AARE, and I would like to welcome you to the joint AARE-NZARE Conference. I would like to thank each member of the Conference's Standing Committee for the outstanding work in contributing in their contribution to this conference. They have been an amazing group of people to work with. I would also like to acknowledge all our colleagues who have travelled to be with us here today, particularly our international colleagues, who obviously heard how exciting the G20 summit was. I'd also like to welcome our delegates in the satellite room, because as I said before, we've had a bit of an overflow, so they're beaming this morning's proceedings into there. Before we commence the formal part of the proceedings, I just need to go through a few housekeeping items. So, in case there is an emergency, please take your belongings with you if it is safe to do so and exit through the nearest fire exits, which are, I feel like an airline steward, there and there, there, there and up there. There are coffee vouchers in your conference satchels, so to complete the circle of life, the toilets can be found outside and just to the left of the auditorium. They're the nearest ones. The instructions for the internet can be found on page 14 of the conference booklet. The speaker's room, please don't forget to upload your presentation in B block, room 240, and the information is on page 12. For any queries, please contact Deb Cracknell, our wonderful office and events manager, or our wonderful New Zealand colleagues as well who have a booth here, or the wonderful people at Think Business Events where you registered. We're also very fortunate to have our wonderful QUT volunteers who are wearing red shirts to help you find the rooms throughout the conference. I would now like to introduce you to Professor Julianne Moss, our hardworking and wonderful president of AARE, who will provide an acknowledgement of the traditional owners of the country on which we have gathered together. Thank you.
Thanks for the promotion, Margaret. It feels good. Hi, welcome. I'm Julianne Moss, and it's been my pleasure to be president of this association for the last 2 years. To commence our proceedings today, I would like to give an acknowledgement of the traditional owners. In keeping with the spirit of reconciliation, I acknowledge the Turrbal, Yagara, Yugara, Kabi Kabi, and Jindara peoples as the traditional owners of the land where QUT now stands, and recognise that these have always been places of teaching and learning. I wish to pay respect to their elders, past and present and emerging, and acknowledge the important role that Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people continue to play within the QUT community and their contribution to the Australian Association of Research in Education. Welcome, and do enjoy our very, very rich program. And to commence the proceedings, I'd like to invite Cheryl Stevens, who is the External Relations Committee member on the New Zealand Association of Research and Education Council, to commence with the proceedings. Thank you.
Tēnā tātou katoa. I'd like to acknowledge the people of this land, on the land on which we are all gathered here today, and endorse the acknowledgements from Julianne Moss. I'd like to now ask Tony Trinick, our representative, to begin the formal ceremony on behalf of NZARE and those gathered here from Aotearoa, New Zealand.
Take the mihi mai, na mauna, o Aotearoa, ki na mauna, o tēnei takiwa. Ke te mihi atu, na mauna, na hawa, ki ngā mate,
Professor Liz Gordon to give us a brief welcome on behalf of NZARE.
Tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā tātou katoa. Ototahi, no Aotearoa, ko Liz Gordon taku ingoa. It's really lovely to be here. We always like coming to Australia. It's a country that's often seen in competition with New Zealand for a range of things. We won't mention rugby while we're here, and you don't mention cricket. But in fact, we're a country with very much in common in a whole range of ways. And one of the things that I hope for this conference is that more collaborative work goes on. I've been reading recently, for example, about your university sector and its various woes, and it reminds me very much of our university sector and its woes. And there's many opportunities, I think, for cross-national research. And looking at some of the models in Europe, you know, there's a lot to be gained, I think, by doing good comparison and collaborative work. I think in the area of
of Māori education and Indigenous people here, there's also huge opportunities for work, and there's many other areas. So I certainly invite you to talk to your colleagues through the SIGs. We've only recently got SIGs in New Zealand, and it's really good that for the first time we're going to have an active collaboration between the SIGs over the next few days. So let's see what comes out of that. Of course, we've been very different in one other areas, and that is our politics. We've always looked with awe and excitement at your really naughty politics in Australia, but we've got our own dirty politics now, and we've even got a book to prove it. So we're catching up on that front. So everyone, I hope you all have a good time. I'm certainly looking forward to having a good time and talking to many of you over the next few days. Kia ora, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Liz, and thank you to NZARE for that very moving welcome. I'd now like to invite Professor Carol Dixon, who is the Senior Deputy Vice-Chancellor at the University of Technology, to officially open our conference. Welcome, Carol.
Well, good morning, everybody. I too acknowledge the traditional owners of the land. The full acknowledgement was provided earlier to you. Thank you for that wonderful welcome from our New Zealand neighbours. I don't think we're in competition. I think we're close neighbours and family. So I hope that you'll enjoy the spirit of our place here in that manner. President of the Australian Association of Research and Education, Associate Professor Julianne Moss. President of the New Zealand Association for Research and Education, Ms. Liz Gordon. Distinguished guests, international and Australian colleagues and friends, good morning. I'm Carol Dickinson, as was said earlier, and on behalf of our Vice-Chancellor, Professor Peter Coldrake, who's unable to be here this morning, I welcome you to QUT, I welcome you to Brisbane, to Kelvin Grove, and to the University. This year we are proud to host this annual association event and conference, and I think you've probably got near record numbers attending, so hopefully that's got something to do with being in Brisbane, but probably not. It's probably just that you're all here together. At QUT we're widely recognised for our real world relevance of our teaching and research to industry, the professions and the broader community. And in keeping with this, we're very proud of our Faculty of Education and its strong national and international research profile. As I look over your program and your conference and ponder the topics that the keynote speakers will talk to you about and challenge you with, I can see that you too are committed to first-class educational research that underpins pedagogical and classroom practice, supports work in global transition, and helps us to address educational and social inequity. I'm delighted to welcome you here to our Kelvin Grove campus. This campus has a long tradition in the field of education and was the original home of the Brisbane Teachers College of Education. And in fact, this year we celebrate 100 years of education at Kelvin Grove and its predecessor institutions. I'm sure you'll hear about that during this conference. We've also transformed this campus a lot. I used to think of it as being like a big school, and it probably was when it was first became the university. But now we have a wonderful array of things that I hope that you can enjoy while you're here. We talk about the upper campus and the lower campus. Down on the lower campus, there are restaurants, cafes, retail, and other activities for you to enjoy, as well as our Creative Industries precinct. And I hope you'll find some nice, cool, shady spots in our heat. And that it's not too hot for you. So again, welcome to QUT. Please accept my very best wishes for your conference. I hope that you are engaged in the program, as I'm sure you will be looking at it. And I hope that you also enjoy the collaboration and challenges of trying to address the issues before you. Thank you and welcome.
So I'd like to introduce our first keynote, and it's always wonderful to introduce both a colleague and someone that you've probably known for, you know, too long that you actually go back through your own sort of academic sort of career and calendar. But it's my pleasure to introduce to you Professor David Hogan. Since July 2013, David Hogan has been an honorary professor at the University of Queensland. Prior to that, he was the professor and principal research scientist at the National Institute of Education in Singapore between 2010 and 2013. He was also professor and dean in the Office of Educational Research. He's also was heavily involved in the Centre for Research in Pedagogy and Practice during a period of, that I think every Australian knew the acronym CRPP. So I would like to invite David to give our first keynote presentation. Welcome, David.
Thanks, Julianne. Good morning, everybody. Just hang on a minute. Thanks. Great, thank you. Today, I want to talk about some of the key research findings from almost 10 years of research in Singapore that I was involved in at the National Institute of Education. Broadly, what I want to do is sort of contextualize the presentation in terms of the very vigorous debate that has occurred in across Western countries about the meaning and importance of the results of TIMSS and PISA, because they have caused no end of hand-wringing and doomsaying across the Western world because of the success of the East Asian countries, including Singapore. So I have five tasks today. The first is to just briefly consider the TIMSS 2011 and the PISA 2012 results. Brief report on the research findings from TIMSS 2011 on instructional practices in Singapore and Australia. There is no instructional data as such in PISA, but TIMSS does have some scales that I can report on. Report some findings from a large research project that I led in Singapore that will focus on the character and the strengths of the instructional regime in Singapore, its underlying logic, its relationship to student achievement, and its limits and opportunity costs. I also want to briefly report on some of the initiatives that Singapore government is now taking to reform Singapore system. And finally, I want to consider some of the implications of these findings for an Australian audience. Before I go further, I do want to thank the ARE organising committee, I shouldn't forget that, for inviting me today, and for Julianne, who I've known now for some 20-odd years. So let me start with TIMSS and PISA. Now, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this because I'm sure you're all familiar with these results. Clearly, Singapore and Australia inhabit different universes, as we can see from these results. This is from TIMSS. It shows the percentage correct at the advanced, the high end of the advanced levels of performance in TIMSS. And you can see that there is quite a substantial deficit between Australia and Singapore, both in terms of the math content area and in the cognitive domains. The cognitive domains are important because it suggests that Singapore is not simply preparing students to do well on exams, but that there is a great deal of cognitive complexity and depth in the work that the students are doing. I'd like you to keep that in mind because it's one of the challenges that researchers like me or us have in trying to interpret the nature of Singapore's success, given the nature of its pedagogical practices. PISA as well, the results are fairly clear, there is a almost a 70-point gap between Singapore and Australia for mathematics. The gap for science and reading is much smaller, but it's still substantial. So it's clear that performance in mathematics is well known, and I'm primarily going to focus on that today. But it's not the only subject, not the only domain in which Singapore has done exceptionally well. And I will make this point later on, this is not as though Australia has done poorly. I mean, Australia does, it scores above the mean for the OECD countries, and in some ways, as I'll show you later on some indicators, it does exceptionally well. And I want to come back to that because I think it's important that Australia not lose confidence in the quality of its teaching and learning. I think that's a key takeaway today. So this is the subscales for PISA in mathematics. It shows that there are higher percentages of students at levels 5 and 6 in PISA across the various areas of mathematics. This is not a hierarchy of cognitive complexity. It's simply mapping out the various domains in mathematics. And it shows that consistently Singapore does substantially better than Australia. Now, these results have caused no little PISA shock or TIM shock and some metaphysical panic. And you can see this in this sort of collage of images. And they range from economic panic that the East Asian tigers are outwitting Australia in terms of their human capital formation, their productivity, their economic growth, eventually their standard of living. So there's a great deal of aggro around that particular issue. There's also a great deal of cultural panic, and particularly from the right wing of Australian politics and their fellow travellers. There's also an effort to or worry about the kind of loss of sovereignty over educational policy matters through the externalisation of policy to the OECD. This is an issue that I know Bob Lingard and Sam Sellers and other colleagues at UQ have been thinking about and writing about for some time. There's a great deal of pedagogical panic as well about, are we doing the wrong thing? What do we need to do to do well, to do better in the classroom? And of course, all of that leads to significant political panic. And in Australia, we've had a series of responses ranging from the creation of the Australian National Curriculum, NAPLAN, the My School website, the various reviews of teacher education to focus on teacher quality, the creation of independent public schools, back to basics, phonics in language and reading, and a whole new accountability structure. So these are the kinds of responses that have been developed by or come out of the policy world in response to Australia's relatively poor performance compared to Singapore on PISA and TIMSS. And this is true across the United States, the United Kingdom. In Europe, it's not as acute because I think they have a broader view about the purposes of education. But certainly in the United States, United Kingdom, and Australia, the three countries that I know best, the story is very, very similar. So how might we explain these differences? Well, probably the leading explanation of the differences between Singapore and Australia has broadly become known in the literature as the East Asian hypothesis. And it broadly has 8 or 9 propositions. The first is that Singapore and other East Asian countries do as well as they do because they have a particular set of cultural formations that are highly supportive of hard work, effort, achievement, and the value of education. There's a particular theory of learning very important. Rather than, as in the West, we tend to see conceptual understanding preceding kind of procedural competency and fluency and automaticity, in Singapore and in East Asian countries, it tends to be the other way around, that procedural fluency and automaticity in mathematics precedes conceptual understanding. And in fact, we have some evidence that I'll show you later that would support that proposition. There's a highly prescriptive curriculum that's tightly aligned with the national high-stakes assessment systems. That's a key feature of East Asian countries, particularly Singapore. There, in general, is a didactic, teacher-dominated classroom instruction. There's a tightly covered institutional arrangements and forms of pedagogical alignment focused on meritocratic assessment and performativity. There's a highly selective teacher recruitment, high-quality pre-service training and PD, hierarchical and prescriptive forms of instructional governance, and performative forms of teacher accountability. And finally, limited forms of democratic accountability that permit extended policy life cycles, long-term planning, policy coherence, and institutional alignment. Now, I think all of these have some credibility. I think the first would be the primary explanation of the differences between East Asia and Australia. Now, that isn't to say that culture is destiny, but we cannot gainsay how extraordinarily important those cultural differences are. And I won't say much about that today because I want to focus on number four, the instructional practices in the classroom. But I want the emphasis on instruction to be in the context of recognising how deeply embedded instructional practices in Singapore are in the kind of the cultural framing of teaching and learning in the Singapore context. Okay, so what happens in the classroom in Singapore? Well, we have data from two sources that I want to report on. The first is from TIMSS 2011, and this shows, and I've taken data from the TIMSS reports, and you can see that Singapore is far more like, Singapore teachers are far more likely to rely upon textbooks than Australia. They are far more likely to use workbooks or worksheets. They are much less likely to rely on concrete objects or materials. And they are about the same as Australia in terms of computer software. So there are some differences. The first two differences are particularly important because that has been a particular focus and a key characteristic of instruction in Singapore and is now being adopted by England under Michael Gove, who, of course, is no longer the minister. But Michael Gove has been pushing this very, very hard through Tim Oakes and the curriculum review in the United Kingdom. Teacher instructional activities. Now, this is quite interesting. Work problems, individually or with peers, with teacher guidance. Australia actually does a lot better. Well, it depends on your normative standard, obviously, but certainly Australia got a higher score there. Work problems together in whole class with direct teacher guidance, they're about the same. Work problems individually or with peers, Australia has a higher score for that. This is a percentage of students doing the following every lesson. Memorise procedure, rules, procedures and facts, 21 to 32. Now, that was a surprise. My expectation was that before I looked at this data, that the figures would be reversed. So for some reason, and I don't have an answer to this reason because I would have thought that you would find a lot more memorization given the reputation of Singapore's pedagogy, that you'd have a lot more memorization in Singapore than Australia. That turns out not to be the case. I can give you a hint later on that might explain why that is, but I'll come to that later. Explain their answers, 46 to 30 in Australia's favour. That's a very substantial difference. And apply facts, concepts and procedures. Again, a very substantial difference. Now, I'll come back to that in a minute. This is the last slide on this from the TIMSS data. Percentage of students whose teachers give test questions every 2 weeks or more, 16 to 39 in Singapore's favour. Percentage of students whose teachers give test questions always, almost always, involved application of mathematical procedures, 84 to Australia, 30 to Australia for involving patterns and relationships, and 37 requiring justification for explanations. So, what does this mean? Well, it's clear that Singapore, on TIMS data, this is a narrow database, admittedly, but and it's based upon self-reports, but it's clear that Singapore has a more conventional, traditional instructional regime focused on workbook, textbooks, and assessments than Australia. But Australia's instructional regime offers apparently a more complex, cognitively complex instructional regime. And we need to take that into account, given the results of TIMS and PISA. So how come Singapore does so much better than Australia on TIMS and PISA, given this apparent difference in the cognitive load of the instructional practices across the two countries? Is it because of Singapore's unique cultural configuration and formations, rather than or despite its instructional regime? Or is it the case that in Singapore's instructional regime, for all its conventionality, is simply better over and above the importance of cultural factors at producing the kind of outcomes that we see in TIMS and PISA? And if this is the case, what might this mean for Australia, pedagogically speaking? And that's sort of the key issue that that I want to end the presentation on today. So I'm going to report on the research that I was involved in. This research program is called the Core Research Program, was initially conceived and developed by Alan Luke and Peter Freebody in 2003-2004. I joined CRPP in 2004 as a vice dean, and then came the dean the year after when Alan left to come back to Australia. At the end of that program in 2008, it was a five-year research program. I was funded for a second round of funding for the core program, what we call Core 2. And we had about, altogether, if we do take into account all the kind of the cross subsidies, we probably $7 or $8 million out of a $100 million budget that we had from the Singapore government. Now, I say that deliberately because I want you to understand how serious the commitment of the Singapore government is to funding educational research. That's $100 million over 5 years. And they've just renewed the third tranche of funding, and the third tranche of funding, I think, is around $80, $85 million on top of the $100 million that was given when I was dean, and the $48 million that Alan Luke and Peter Freebody received from the government. So we're looking at $250 million over 15 years. That's really, really serious money. Okay, so this is the research team, the core. We had about 34 people involved in this research project. Its design, there were three panels, panel two, panel three, panel five. I won't go into the origins of these panels. You can see that panel two was essentially a survey of teachers and students. We essentially kind of a repeated measures design, pre-test, post-test, of a nationally representative sample of schools, primary five and secondary three. Students, you see the numbers there. We also assessed students in either their particular domain, maths or English, or primary five, primary three, secondary three, in either mathematics or English. In panel three, we took a sample of the larger panel two sample and selected some 115 units of work to look at very closely. So we used video cameras. We had three video cameras in each room and six microphones for each lesson. And we then observed, coded, and then transcribed and analyzed, coded all of those lessons. So we had a code book that had 414 indicators across about 35 scales. And we coded all of those every 3 minutes. So you can imagine the data size that we had. So we had a very, very rich data set to capture the sequence over not just over a lesson, but over an entire unit of work. And then panel five involved the same sample as panel three. And what we did here is to focus on the tasks that, and particularly the class tasks, the homework tasks, the assessment tasks the teachers gave students. And we analysed and coded the tasks that the teachers gave. And secondly, we then collected and coded the data, the student artefacts that were reproduced in response to the teachers' tasks. So we had a really rich data set. So we can compare on across a whole range of indicators of cognitive and epistemic complexity, the quality of the work that the teacher would have embedded in task set up and the work that the students did in response. So I'm going to report some of the results from all three, but principally panel two and panel three. So what do we find? Our key finding, number one, is that in general, and this is a very general statement about the overall structure or character of instructional practice in Singapore, is that it's highly pragmatic, it's fit for purpose, it's highly instrumental, it's hybridic, it's non-sectarian and sharply focused on preparing students for local semestral and national high stakes and international assessments. That is what is particularly distinctive about Singapore's pedagogy. We describe this as a performative pedagogy. It's focused on performance on assessment. Now, recall that Singapore, unlike Australia, doesn't have a large mineral base or an agriculture base. Its entire occupational structure and social mobility patterns are dependent upon educational credentials. Everybody knows it, everybody believes in it, and most people work hard at doing well in it. So it's not surprising that it has this performative orientation. It's a part of the cultural world that Singaporeans generally inhabit. While it has a very strong emphasis on knowledge transmission and reproduction, therefore, it also includes elements of what we would call, a knowledge-building pedagogy, cognitively speaking, and I will say a bit more about that later. But the knowledge-building emphasis is relatively weak because most of the emphasis, the primary emphasis, is on knowledge transmission and reproduction. So it's quite a traditional, conventional framework for teaching and learning in Singapore. I didn't plan that, I'm sure. Right. The second key finding is that in Singapore, and I suspect elsewhere as well, the intellectual quality of the knowledge work that takes place in the classroom is primarily dependent on the design and implementation of instructional tasks, rather than the specific instructional strategies that teachers employ, or surprisingly, extended epistemic or knowledge talk in the classroom. And that reason, we didn't expect that. Having spent years talking to Alan and Peter about classroom talk, I fully expected that to be a critical issue. But in Singapore classroom, there's not a lot of student talk. Most of the talk is done by teachers, and I'll show you some data to back that up in a moment. The person who wrote the classic paper on the value, on the importance of tasks and the nature of tasks is Walter Doyle, who wrote a famous paper in 1983 called The Nature of Academic Work in the Classroom. And that paper has driven a whole tradition of research in education up to this present time. So I've got a list of other people who kind of adopt, and these are only a very small slice, so James Hebert in mathematics, Mary Kay Stein, University of Pittsburgh in mathematics, Fred Newman, who at the University of Wisconsin, who was the godfather for the productive pedagogies, new basics in Queensland, Dick Elmore at Harvard, who I'll say more about later, and Tony Bright, one of the inventors of multi-level modelling, and now was at Chicago, then at Stanford, and is now president of one of the big foundations in the United States. And of course, I think there is an implicitly the new basics framework for the notion of rich tasks is a sense of how important tasks are as well. And Martin Mills, Bob Lingard, Jim Ladwig, Alan Luke and others, all involved in framing the value of rich tasks as a key driver of high quality pedagogy. So why tasks? This is just, I've only got two quotes from academics, and this is one of them. This is from Fred Newman and Anthony Bright. And what they are saying is that this is from work that they did in Chicago, from working from the Pew Trust funding project. What they are essentially saying is that what really matters in terms of driving the quality of instruction in the classroom was not the specific instructional strategies that teachers used, but the quality of the instructional tasks. That was critical. And our work in Chicago and in Singapore, I think, supports that proposition. So, what are instructional tasks? Well, our operational definition was they are discrete, purposeful, goal-directed student learning activities focused on some forms of knowledge work that regulate opportunities to learn and the exercise of specific forms of cognitive, epistemic, collaborative, discursive, textual, digital, and metacognitive agency, and therefore determines the kind and quality of knowledge work students engage in during lessons. It shapes the overall structure of instructional practice during the lesson, and it mediates the knowledge work of the classroom and the knowledge work that takes place in the workplace. So this has broader institutional significance. It's not just limited to the classroom, but actually links to the broader world of work. And in an environment in which policymakers are and educators are thinking a lot about the nature of knowledge economies and knowledge work in knowledge economies, this is a critical, I think, link. In fact, for those of you who are old enough who remember Bowles and Guinness's work in the 1970s and their notion of the correspondence principle, this is actually a restatement of that principle, although doesn't take the form that they did, because they were looking at essentially kind of behavioral expectations. This is really about the nature of the knowledge work that takes place in the classroom. So there are many different kinds of taxonomies of tasks. The one that I have found most useful is one that differentiates between knowledge transmission tasks, the acquisition of domain-specific knowledge and skills, like doing review, remembering, practice, drill, et cetera, and then knowledge building tasks, which have two elements. Knowledge building, cognitively speaking, which focuses upon tasks that are focused on developing understanding, conceptual understanding, making connections, interpreting, explaining, compare and contrast, et cetera, and then epistemic, which is a classical epistemological notion that knowledge building is not something that simply goes on in the head. Fundamentally, it's about securing publicly warranted knowledge claims and in domain-specific areas, mathematicians, historians, physicists, chemists, whatever, engage in different kinds of knowledge practices to generate knowledge claims, which they then test and justify against domain-specific epistemic norms. So I'm going to talk about that in the context of mathematics, just very briefly, a little later, because this is it. If we are going to think about the relationship between education and the knowledge economy, we have to be thinking about the nature of the epistemic work, the epistemic practices that students engage in class. It's not simply about cognitive understanding. And that's, on the side I've got photos of Marlene Scardamalia and Carl Berida, who have been very important in popularizing the notion of knowledge building, but it's a broadly conceptual, a cognitive understanding rather than an epistemic one. And what I've wanted to do is to build on their notion and extend it and make it an epistemic notion as well. So I'll report some of the results a little shortly. This is a kind of a formal model for thinking about tasks. If you go back to tasks as opportunity systems, multidimensional opportunity systems, that give students an opportunity to engage in particular kinds of cognitive, epistemic, collaborative, discursive, and so on. This is a way of thinking about it. It's a way of framing it. And so what we did in the Core 2 program, we actually measured the extent to which students were able to engage in this kind of work as a part of the tasks. Now, many tasks will be completely silent on these issues. There'll be no opportunity for collaborative work with others in group work. There'll be no text production. There'll be no digital production agency. There'll be no opportunity to develop or exercise metacognitive agency. There will always be some opportunity to exercise cognitive work, but it will vary in kind, and I'll say a little bit more about that. So this is a way of thinking about what are the kinds of activities that constitute a task, an instructional task. And so this was a kind of the broad framework that drove our framing and analysis. So I'm just going to focus on three today: cognitive, epistemic, and discursive agency. This is from panel two, which is the survey of secondary three students in mathematics and English. And we asked the students to report against a range of about, the taxonomy was taken from Anderson and Krathwohl's revised taxonomy, and they've got 21 or 22 indicators. And they have a particular hierarchical structure. When we factor analyze the results, we didn't get anything like their structure at all. We don't think their structure makes sense. But what we did when we tested this through both exploratory and confirmatory factor analysis, we got these two broad factors, which for analytical purposes was quite useful. So one was what we call functional cognition, which is, you know, to remember, to practice, to do research, to find information, to drill, and so on. And complex cognition are activities, interrogation, interpretation, comprehension, text production, explaining, making connections, and so on. So these are more complex cognitive demands. And you can see that in mathematics, functional cognition is substantially higher than complex cognition, and in the same is true in English, but the gap is much narrower. So the correlations, interestingly enough, in both subjects are quite high, particularly in mathematics. That shows that they two go together. They're not orthogonal. Teachers tend to use both. So it's not, they just use more likely to engage students in tasks that require functional forms of cognitive activity rather than complex ones. In English, it's about the correlation is weaker, so they tend to do one of the more. We actually tested this out with the panel three observational study, and we found that in both subjects where we asked the coders actually coded whether an event happened during the three minute period, which is on an hour period, an hour lesson, that would be 20 periods. So what we found is that in both subjects, but particularly in English, both the functional and the complex went together in the same period, whereas one or the other was much rarer. So, and that's reflected in the correlation from the survey data. We also looked at, this is from panel three, the observational study, we looked at what kind of knowledge was the focus of the lesson, of the instructional task. And both in English, in mathematics to begin with, we see that the percentage of phases in a lesson, there are 20 phases in a lesson. In mathematics, 41% of phases, there was evidence of factual knowledge that was a part of the task. Procedural knowledge was 80% of all of the phases in a lesson. So clearly a strong procedural focus. In English, on the other hand, it's the other way around. There's a stronger focus on factual knowledge than on procedural knowledge. Now, you might wonder, that was a surprise to us, because we thought that English more likely would have a much stronger focus on conceptual and maybe rhetorical knowledge, hermeneutical knowledge, but in fact, that wasn't the case. So, and that's because in Singapore's English lessons, there's a very strong focus on grammar, on correct syntax. And so it's mastering the kind of basic factual information. So we see that conceptual knowledge in mathematics is well behind procedural knowledge, and that is, and for English, that is, it's even much lower than that. Metacognitive knowledge rarely made its appearance in lessons. This is tracking that knowledge focus across lessons. So we can see from at the very beginning, phase one to phase, some lessons went beyond an hour. So you can see that over there. The top line is kind of is procedural knowledge in mathematics, and below that is factor. So you can see that the focus is consistent right across the lesson. So it just don't do factual knowledge at the beginning or procedural knowledge at the beginning, but it's across. In fact, the factual knowledge declines in mathematics over time. In English, you can see they run much more closely together over the course of the lesson, and the gap is not nearly as great, which we saw from the table. These are the knowledge practices that we measured for in mathematics. So first of all, we sort of have this taxonomy built around knowledge communication, that is working with syntax, knowledge representation, representing mathematical problems, symbolically, visually, any way that's possible, generating knowledge claims, knowledge deliberation, knowledge justification, or validation, and knowledge communication, again, as in presentation. And we can see that the percentage of phases for knowledge communication, syntax, and knowledge representation, and finally presentation, are by far and away the strongest forms of knowledge work, the knowledge practices that students engage in Singapore. We see that knowledge generation, deliberation, and justification, which you might think of in mathematics as at the heart of the conceptual work that takes place in mathematics, that has a much lower presence in Singapore's mathematics than the other three. So it's about mastery of syntax and mastery of communication and representation. In fact, the Singapore pioneered the use of the model method in mathematics, in algebra, and many of you will be familiar with that. Okay, discursive agency, the structure of classroom talk. What we see is that by far and away, most questions in the classroom are closed questions. They're not open questions. They're not questions that invite students to speculate, to hypothesize, to reflect. They are simply what conventionally are called IRE questions. What's the right answer to this? What is the answer to this question? Response from students. The teacher says yes or no, right or wrong. You can see that overwhelmingly questions are closed rather than open-ended. Now, you wouldn't find that in Australia. I mean, I haven't done this kind of research in Australia, but the profile would be dramatically different. And then, secondly, this looks at the teacher responses to student responses. Now, this is actually, from the work that's been done on classroom talk, we know that the teacher response to the student's response is actually often the most critical juncture in the exchange that takes place, because that's where the teacher is able to elaborate on the student's ideas. And what we find is that, however, in Singapore, the responses are overwhelmingly short. Teachers don't elaborate. They don't give medium to long-term or extended responses. Okay, so this is epistemic talk. This is talk about knowledge. And we've got, similar to the focus, the analysis of our focus on the nature of the epistemic knowledge, we've got factual, procedural, clarifying talk. Clarifying talk is talk a talk that when the student asks the teacher, what do you mean? Could you say that again? It's just asking to repeat what the teacher said. Connecting talk, of course, is making, it's the heart of conceptual work, making connections between different ideas, building up a conceptual network of ideas and relationships, and then explanatory, justification, reflexive, and then the epistemic virtues, which talks about, you know, what are the kinds of virtues of a good mathematician, what kind of habits of mind should you develop and exhibit. You can see overwhelmingly that the dominant form of talk is procedural, as we would find, as we found with the focus on knowledge focus. So the same profile we get for English as we got for the epistemic focus. This is a question that Alan and Peter asked in Core 1, and it's about the extent to which teachers allow kind of debate about the epistemic status of knowledge claims. Is knowledge presented as truth, or is it presented as a contestable claim? Something that can be tested, debated, compared, and what we find is overwhelmingly knowledge is presented as truth rather than as a contestable claim. It's not debatable, it's objective, it's simply stated, and that's it. So let me turn to the key finding 3, which is focused on instructional strategies. We found evidence in Singapore of 4 generic instructional strategies: traditional, direct, teaching for understanding, and co-regulated learning strategies, which the students are involved in co-design of the learning strategies. We found that the first, the traditional, was the strongest, and followed by direct. And then there's a big gap for teaching for understanding. These are multidimensional scales, so they have many individual subscales and indicators. And we find that co-regulated learning strategies go up at the end. Now, what we can see is that in mathematics, traditional instruction, this is from the panel 2 survey data, is around 3.69, 3.45 in English. Direct instruction is stronger in English than it is than traditional instruction in English, but a little below what it is in mathematics. This is all to be expected, nothing unusual here. Teaching for understanding, a fair way back in both subjects, and then co-regulated learning strategies further back. So that's the kind of the hierarchy of instructional strategies. Now, what's interesting about these is not just simply their relative frequency, but the fact that they are highly correlated. And this was a big surprise and a real clue to figuring out the nature of pedagogy in Singapore. Because what it suggests is that these instructional strategies are not competitive. They're not alternative. They're not orthogonal. They are complementary, and teachers select and use when they're fit for purpose. This underscores, I think, the hybridic nature of classroom teaching in Singapore. Singapore teachers are not sectarian. They don't belong to a particular church, a pedagogical church or faith or sect. They simply adopt a particular strategy as it's fit for purpose, which is extremely sensible and thought and in the way that they use it. So high correlations, except the correlations for co-regulated learning strategies are much weaker. So we also looked at what we call high leverage instructional strategies, which is similar to John Hattie's notion of visible teaching and learning, but broader than that, because we're looking at some additional measures. But you can see that checking for prior relevant knowledge, we found little evidence of that. And this is a key kind of constructivist principle of teaching and learning. Communicating learning goals, communicating learning performance standards, providing exemplars of successful performance, mentoring student learning. Now, we found high levels of mentoring for summative mentoring, but very low for formative. Feedback, evaluative, that is making a judgment about whether the learning is good or bad, was high, but detailed descriptive was low, and formative feedback, which is what Hattie and Dylan Williams and Paul Black and others have emphasized, was low, very low. learning support or scaffolding. We differentiated between procedural, logistical, and strategic. We found procedural learning support constant, ever-present, and high. We found logistical low, and we found strategic very low. So what we don't find then is Singapore teachers using the kind of the ensemble, the repertoire of instructional practices that in the West have become associated with constructivist or social constructivist or teaching for understanding learning frameworks, teaching and learning frameworks. But yet they still do remarkably well. So again, the sort of the tension between this kind of, if you come, as I do, from a broadly constructivist view about learning, how do we make sense of how does this very traditional instructional regime produce such high levels of results that are also produce high levels of performance on the kind of more complex forms, as we saw from the TIMSS and PISA? So this is our feedback, just shows you the relative distribution, and then for learning support as well. Okay, in sum, Singapore looks like this. I've showed you this before. This is a, I can't show you much of this because it's quite complicated, but I actually recruited two mathematicians from physics department in Singapore who do functional analysis, which is way beyond my skill level and pay grade, and use some networks. They actually map galaxies. So what they were using, what they use this mathematics for, this network analysis, is to see the relationship in space and time between different kinds of instructional strategies. Now, the size and direction and thickness of these nodes and pathways are important. They're all weighted statistically by the probability of them occurring and of the causal direction and the relationships between the different nodes. You can see that the center of gravity of Singapore pedagogy is knowledge is truth. And it's around that you find procedural talk and all the other kind of elements of a transmissive pedagogy. The more conceptual areas of work in mathematics are spread further out into the outer regions of the universe. Some even disappear into a black hole, never to be seen again. So what we can actually do, I won't do it now because I don't have the time, we can actually show this over time. We can sequence this across the entire lesson. So you can show a movie of a lesson on how it progresses and how these relationships congeal, break apart, reform together, or whatever. So it's a really, really powerful technique. We've just, having published this, we've just got an article that's been conditionally accepted for publication in a physics journal that explains the mathematics and the physics of this. I don't understand the technical part of this at all. But it's a very, we supplied the data and the sort of the theoretical framing, but it's a really powerful way. When I showed this to the ministry, the minister and the senior executive last year in Singapore, I showed this for both primary five mathematics and English, and the same for secondary three mathematics and English. My scheduled talk was for 40 minutes, 45 minutes. We spent 2.75 hours, and we spent well over an hour just looking and talking about these ranges because they can show visually the relationships between different kinds of pedagogical practice and over time during the course of the lesson. So it's a very powerful analytical tool. So why do Singapore teachers teach this way? They teach this way for a fairly straightforward number of reasons. They teach this way primarily because of the national high stakes assessment and the national curriculum and parent pressure. Now, we interviewed all of the teachers in our panel three survey, which is 115, we interviewed them at length about the why do they teach this way? And the responses were interchangeable. They all said the same thing, pretty much. But they weren't scripted. This is what they broadly said. And I could add, so I could add lots. Now, what this quotation indicates is that there are kind of key drivers that drive instructional behaviour in Singapore classroom. And I think this has a lot of resonance for Australia, given the policy settings of Australian education currently. The prescribed curriculum, covering the curriculum. These are kind of key institutional rules. This is what drives teacher behaviour. And this is an area, these are the issues that is almost never taken into account when policymakers or researchers or whoever think about changing what happens in the classroom. You have to think about institutions, institutional rules and practices, as well as the specific instructional practices. The national high stakes test, teaching to the test, a kind of pervasive folk pedagogy that is accepted at faith. Teaching is talking and learning is listening. Effort and hard work, not ability, explain differences in student achievement, and so on. I mean, there are a dozen of these that I could have put in. Meritocratic norms, streaming is both fair and efficient. Parent and student expectations, a very high instrumental value of education. Performative teacher accountabilities, teachers are evaluated on the performance of their students, as increasingly Australian teachers are. I don't know about New Zealand. And commitment to collective wellbeing. Education is a key nation-building project. Now, this is a foreign discourse in Australia. But in Singapore, students and teachers take seriously their obligations, their membership of the national community. And you cannot discount that. Singapore is often, and East Asian countries, often called collectivist. But this is collective in a positive way. And they care about the collective wellbeing. They have a sense of collective membership. And Singapore is not an especially democratic society. It's a weak democracy at best. But it's very clear that the system is highly responsive to popular opinion because it's constantly monitoring what the community thinks and feels, and the citizens and their children have a strong commitment to the Singapore story. Now, I know there's some colleagues here from Singapore who will support that proposition. So, those are the key drivers. Now, I've got a formal diagram of this, but it's too complicated, and I'm going to run out of time if I show it, so I want to move on quickly. So, I'm just going to do something very quickly about the relationship between student achievement, student and instructional practices, and student achievement. What we did is... We used a statistical technique called multi-level path modelling or structural equation modelling. And rather than go into the statistics that are involved, I just want to show you conceptually what these models look like and what we found. That's the simple model. This is a more extended model. On the left-hand side, or on my left-hand side, are the instructional strategies, structural tasks, and classroom tools. They're the three sets of instructional practices that we focused on. And then over on the right-hand side, you've got the student achievement. Prior achievement is inevitable because we know from years of research that prior achievement is one of, if not the strongest predictor of student achievement, over and above anything else. But we also want to look at the relationship between prior achievement and family background. In Singapore, kids are streamed on the basis of their prior achievement at the high-stakes exams at year six, primary six, and secondary four. Classroom composition then is an outgrowth of who goes to class with whom, and then the kind of subjective learning resources that students bring with them to the class. Their motivation, their engagement, their self-beliefs, whether it be self-concept or self-efficacy, their commitment, their perseverance, collaboration, and so on. These are all kind of influenced the nature of what teachers do and are influenced in turn by what teachers do. And there are both direct and indirect effects of these on student achievement. So just to show you one quick one, just what a model like this looks like. What this actually shows is it's a multi-level model. Now, because in Singapore, students are streamed, it means that there's very little variation within classrooms in terms of student performance. because they are strengthened on the basis of their prior achievement. So what we see here, if you look at the within results, the relationship between SES, prior achievement and mathematics achievement, these relationships are non-significant. Now that would not be the case in Australia, because in Australia, classes, well, not always, but very often, are quite heterogeneous. The grouping is not by prior achievement. So if it is, it's much weaker than it is in Singapore. So you don't get as much variation, what we call level one. At level two, however, we find the relationships remarkably strong, so that we see that there's a very high coefficient for the pathway from SES to prior achievement and from prior achievement to mathematics achievement. In English, there's a separate direct pathway from SES to mathematics achievement that underscores the importance of cultural capital in the family and linguistic capital as an independent determinant of student achievement. And then we can see, if we look at the instructional side, this is going back to parts of the epistemic focus of tasks, we see that the originating exogenous variable is epistemic knowledge, knowledge of rules, mathematical rules, norms. And then that has that has a strong relationship to and predictive of metacognitive knowledge, and then procedural knowledge. Here, these are not mapping frequencies. They're mapping how well, in a multivariate environment, one variable predicts another, controlling for the others. So then that predicts procedural knowledge, and fundamentally and critically, procedural knowledge predicts conceptual knowledge. So this is, I think, a key to Singapore's pedagogy. It's procedural fluency, automaticity, that is the basis in Singapore for developing student understanding. That then obviously feeds into complex cognition, then into functional cognition, but the only independent pathway from knowledge focus and cognition is via functional cognition. Now that's what you would expect in Singapore, and it's a strong one. So this again shows that this highlights the performative character of Singapore pedagogy, but it also indicates that you've got to look behind the scenes. You simply can't look at correlations or even at beta values in a multiple regression. You've got to look at the relationships. You've got to understand the ecology, the structure of instructional behaviour in the classroom. And that's critical going forward. So this kind of statistical procedure, I think, can help unpack the inner life of instructional practice in a way that more conventional forms of statistical analysis are unable to do. And this is not without its problems, and there are all sorts of challenges in doing this work, but it can be done and it can be enormously suggestive. So this is for instructional strategies. I'm not going to show you the formal model. You can see what we found is that traditional instruction, actually I do have just for traditional and direct, we can see that this is on the left-hand side, you've got exam preparation, worksheets, textbooks, drill, structure and clarity, frequency of practice, frequency of questions, revision. You can see there's only one pathway from this set of values, of variables, in a mathematics achievement, and it's from frequency of practice. That, again, underscores the performative character. But I want you to notice the number of pathways that are generated by exam preparation. There are, 5 pathways. Just when we add teaching for understanding to this model, which I'm not going to show you, there are a total of 9 pathways generated by exam prep. You can see the effects flow right through the system from beginning to end. So, and you have both, there are no direct effects, there's no direct pathway from exam prep to mathematics achievement, but there are multiple indirect pathways, so that you would have to multiply out the pathway from exam prep to worksheet to drill and so on, and then add all these pathways together. Interestingly enough, in Singapore, and this may be why Singapore teachers don't do memorization as much, it's a dead end. It doesn't predict student performance. So what teachers are doing in Singapore are kind of selecting, I won't go into this, what time do I have to finish? 5 minutes? Okay, I'm going to skip, I'm going to skip quickly through to some of the implications for Australia. But broadly what this suggests is, well, in epistemic talk, what we found is that the only one form of talk predicts student performance, and that's performative talk. Everything else had no direct effect at all. So we have a instructional regime that has an impact on student achievement, but it's selective. Only certain kinds of instructional practices, and those are the ones that teachers recognise as having an impact on student achievement. So it's a sensible, rational, organised pedagogy that's focused on student performance. Okay, I want to skip over this. There are limits to the Singapore model. It creates aversion to risk and innovation. It generates a tension between covering topics in depth and covering them for performance. It creates perverse instructional incentives and it results in restricted attention to knowledge building and 21st century instructional tasks. Although despite millions of dollars, tens of millions of dollars of investment in ICT mediated tasks, there's very little evidence that they have bitten, or sorry, had bitten in 2010 when we did this work. There's a high levels of task infidelity, which is to say the quality of the task is, it's a task setup is nothing like what it is at the end. This is adapted from Mary Kay Stein at Pittsburgh, at the Pittsburgh lab that Lauren Resnick runs, or did run. So this is the cognitive demands of the instructional task as laid out in the curriculum documents. Then as the task set up by teachers. So in between those is the teacher interpreting what the task requires. And then the task is implemented by the teacher has even less cognitive demand because the teacher is pressed by time to cover the curriculum and so on and get the kids ready for exams, so you get a shrinking, a dumbing down of the task. And then, of course, at the end, you get what the student does itself. So you get this kind of almost linear progression over time in the decline of the cognitive and epistemic quality of the task. Now, we actually measured this with the panel 5 data, collecting the artifacts and the tasks. You can see it as bright as day. Teachers would ask tasks or set tasks that have high cognitive and epistemic load, but they would come back. The artifacts that come back were essentially factual and procedural, not conceptual. So it happens again and again. So there's another tension between two forms of professional responsibility. Responsible teaching, institutionally speaking, getting kids ready for the exam, and responsible teaching, professionally speaking, the kinds of commitments that teachers have to professional norms. Teachers feel, and we've got this again and again and again, teachers feel this real existential tension between these two forms of responsibility. And there's very little effort to mediate and moderate that tension. Teachers don't get support. They have to live with this tension. But it's a tension that pervades the teaching profession in Singapore. Okay, and then streaming, of course. Singapore model has been revised, is currently, and it has been in the process of revision for the last 10 years. Or more, since the launch of Teach Less, Learn More in 2004. There have been successive additional policy initiatives that have been added since then, but what they want to go is to something like this. This is not a system that is going to sit still. They're very well aware of the demands of a knowledge economy, and they know that they, in order to do the high-value manufacturing and services that they provide, they need to be have a pedagogy that is different. And for 10 years, they have struggled to develop a new pedagogy. That's why they put all that money into research, that $250 million to figure out how to make this happen. So, and they're willing, at least some people are willing, to sacrifice their performance in TIMSS and PISA in order to get here in the short term, short to medium term. I want to play the long game. Now, in that policy environment where there's a 40-odd year policy timeline, they can play the long game. So they're planning for how Singapore is going to perform. Not in the next, in 2015, PISA assessment. They're planning for how Singapore is going to do in 2030, 2025. They're playing the long game. So they don't want to just focus on, they know they're really good on assessments. They want to figure out, what do we have to do to prepare students for the new world that's coming into play? So I'll go on. This is, what are the implications for Australia? I'm going to do this pretty quickly. Peter Renshaw is sitting up there. I showed him, I sent this to him over the weekend. He said, you've got to spend 20 minutes on this section. But I can't. This will be distributed, I'm sure, Julianne, right? So you'll be able to read this at your own leisure. I just want to make a couple of general comments. One is that I think it's important to recognise that Australia performs well above the OECD average in both TIMS and PISA. There is no reason to despair. While we might be not doing as well as Singapore or Shanghai, there's no reason, I think, to despair. There's too much doomsaying about Australia's performance. I think we've got to have confidence in ourselves. We've got to stop this hand-wringing and recognise that we are doing things quite well. And if you look at another PISA result, this was released late last year, early this year, I can't remember now, on problem solving. Now, look at the gap between Singapore and Australia. It's much, much narrower. Now, problem solving is important because it's actually at the heart of OECD PISA strategy for preparing and testing for knowledge economies, which involves being able to work two key skills, complex cognitive work and complex communication. And what they have been working on for the last couple of years is designing tasks that will be in next year's PISA. I'm sure there are people from ACR in Melbourne who know what's going on, who are here, but that's a key issue that they're dealing with. So Australia does quite well. I mean, it may be number nine, but you know, given the competition, this is remarkably good. And I think we need to stop worrying about too much about a performance on domain-specific performances, maths, English, whatever, but pay attention to these more complex cognitive tasks. I think this is good news for Australia. And we ought to be, rather than having people put up the maths and English and reading scores, the science scores, this is the one we should be paying attention to. This is a good news story. Okay, the overall quality of instructional practice in Australia, data rather, we have, is very limited, so I can't really talk about, we have the TIMS data, but we don't have much else. So, but clearly the quality needs improvement. I would strongly recommend that we not try to follow the East Asian path in maximising performance on assessment, but we think clearly and deeply about the nature of the key learning objectives that are important for this country in this cultural and institutional environment. And for my sake and for my view about future demands of a knowledge economy for Australia, it has to be on these particular kinds of learning outcomes, not on performance in TIMS and PISA. That'll take care of itself. In fact, my sense is that one won't lead to two, but two will, over time, generate one. So these are the kinds of steps that we need to get there. I think it's critical that we focus on instructional tasks and the instructional core more broadly, because I think it's teaching and learning. That ought to be the focus of reform initiative. It's not about accountability, it's not about standards, it's not about teacher training, it's about improving the quality of teaching and learning in the classroom. That's where the leather hits the road. That's what we've got to focus on. And the heart of that is designing instructional tasks that have this kind of complexity, and assessment tasks that allow us to capture some of this complexity. Now, I know there was a lot of work going on internationally, including the consortium that's being run out of the University of Melbourne, which Singapore is a part of, or at least I think it maybe still is. I thought I heard that it stopped out. But nevertheless, there is a lot of work going on designing instructional tasks that capture elements of this for assessment. So that's where we've got to go. We've got to build capacity. It's capacity building rather than accountability that will drive the system forward. And now there are a range of models of capacity building in professional learning, professional development. Some are more effective than others. I'm not going to go through these, but clearly we didn't test all of these in Singapore. Some of this I'm just drawing my own inferences from my reading of the research literature. But we did some of this, and we know how effective or how efficacious many of these were. The ones that I'm particularly attractive to are ones that don't focus on working with individual teachers and their pedagogical content knowledge, but ones that work collectively with all teachers in a school or a network to develop or to engage in what I call pedagogical knowledge building that is shared across the profession. And there are different models for that. Observation and videography by teams of teachers. The Japanese lesson study, which I know this one quite well because I funded a couple of projects for this in Singapore. And this is an incredibly effective and powerful form of professional learning. It's collaborative because it involves teachers working together to design and test instructional tasks, try out different strategies. They don't work, they modify, they sit in and watch each other's class, and then they modify them and test them. It works. The trouble with it is that it's very demanding of time, and unless there is significant attention given to class load, it's not sustainable. And we need to be thinking about it. In fact, I'll say this. One of the key issues is that I know unions are very committed to reduction of class size. I think that's the wrong strategy. The right strategy is reduction of class load. It's class load that gives teachers time to reflect, to think, to plan, to collaborate, to work together, to develop their knowledge base and understanding, to explore student understandings. That's where I think the efforts ought to be. Wherever possible, incorporate complex 21st century knowledge tasks, including rich tasks, into high stakes assessment. Because if they're in the high stakes assessment, that will drive teacher behavior. Teachers will teach the test. So it has an inbuilt logic. It's like the Adam Smith's invisible hand. It will drive the process forward. Invest in reducing class load. Invest in equity. Implement Gonski. Now, I don't know how many people here are going to object to that. For those of you in New Zealand, Gonski is the big funding proposal, reform proposal, that was developed a couple of years ago under the previous Labor government, which was an attempt to equalise funding or to improve funding for disadvantaged schools in particular. But has been the current government is dragging its feet on its implementation. This is a huge problem for Australia. Compared to Singapore, I didn't expect this, compared to Singapore, inequality in Australia is a bigger problem than it is in Singapore. There are more students at level two or below in Singapore, in Australia than in Singapore, whereas there are a lot more at level five and six in Singapore than Australia. The number of resilient students are students who do better than you predict on the basis of their family background. In 2012, there are only 6.3% of the cohort who are resilient in Australia, 15% in Singapore. In 2009, the number was even higher in Australia and lower in Singapore. So the trends are going differently. It's getting worse in Australia and getting better in Singapore. So this is a serious challenge for Australia going forward. Okay, culture matters, but it's not destiny. There are policy matters and can make a difference. Pedagogy can make a difference. And there are, I think, protocols, heuristics that we can employ to improve the effectiveness of our efforts for instructional improvement. And then we need finally to be wary, to beware of the traps for the unwary. And these are be careful of kind of an overpreening, overly prescriptive curriculum, and NAPLAM. We don't want NAPLAM to turn into the kind of control mechanism that it is in East Asia. We want teacher and school accountability systems that don't constrain risk-taking and innovation. We need broader brand accountability mechanisms. Bob Lingard, Peter Renshaw, and others are working on what they called rich accountability model that allows individual schools and teachers to report what they and their community value in learning outcomes. It's not just about reporting NAPLAN scores or OP levels. This is what these communities value, and that needs to be part of the reporting mechanism. I think it's really good work, and I'd urge you to follow up on that. No cherry picking from other countries. Be careful what you wish for. Diane Ravitch, who I crossed swords with many years ago, she was one of the warrior queens for the Reagan Revolution in the 1980s with Chester Finn, who were attempting, after the A Nation at Risk report came out in 1983, to impose a whole new kind of accountability system in the United States with standards, testing, assessment, privatization, voucher schools, and so on. What she has learnt, and I was absolutely shocked when I read her recantation, is that she now concludes that model doesn't work. It has been a disaster for the United States. And we've got to move to not an accountability standards testing model, but to a capacity building framework. That's the strategy going forward. And this is a book that I didn't know about until last week when I got the New York Review of Books, and there's a review by her of a book by Yong Zhou, and it's about the kind of be careful what you wish for, because if you wish for what Shanghai achieves, then there are some very unhappy side effects and consequences of that commitment. So my last comment is that there are no answers, there are no simple solutions to solving the problems of improving teaching and learning. In pedagogy, as in life and in the movies, there's no magic bullet, no metaphysical redemption, no holy grail. And with that, I'll thank you very much.
Well, I'm sure you would like to thank David for his willingness to deliver what really has been the summing up of 10 years' work at the Australian Association of Research and Education. And I think we should feel very privileged that you are prepared to be able to bring that kind of robust analysis. And as we all know, the policy context is one that we actually want to break apart from an informed perspective. And I think we speak of all of us for that sense of hope that you give by providing us that kind of analysis, the strengths that we have in the Australian context, but also highlight really sharply the kind and the nature of the way that the work should be inscribed. So, and we would be very happy to have your slides on the AARE website. And
I will do that. I also add references. So different slides have got references, so I will add the references as well.
Yeah. So, and also, David's partner, Laurie, thank you so much as well. She said she moved up to the back so she didn't have to cry. And I realised why that was a good idea to move. So thank you both for sharing with us the opening keynote address. And David will be around during the conference for some of the time.
Yep, happy, yeah. Happy to be here.
So deep appreciation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Julianne. Thank you very much. I hope everyone enjoys the conference. I think it's a very rich conference. I think there are 420 sessions of some extraordinary number. I mean, this compares almost to ARA in the United States. So have a good conference, everybody. Thank you very much.
So before we break for morning tea, an important part of the work of the Australian Association, ANZARE, is the award to our members who have made a distinctive contribution. So in the next few minutes, it's my pleasure to be able to share with you the 2014 nomination for the Honorary Life Membership of the Australian Association of Research in Education. So I have immense pleasure in announcing that the 2014 Honorary Life Membership of the Australian Association of Research in Education is Professor Joanne Reid. Now, before I hand over the certificate, I've just got a few short words that I'd like to share with you from the nomination of Jo as our 2014 Life Member. Jo's been a member of AARE for over 20 years, and during that time, she made significant contributions to AARE and teacher education research policy nationally and internationally. She has a long history of contributions to literacy research. Still got some of those early books, Jo, on my shelf. Particularly in the area, in the areas of Indigenous education and an enduring commitment to improving the preparation for teachers in rural and remote areas. She began a career as a secondary English teacher and then worked as a curriculum consultant for beginning teachers with the Western Australian Department of Education. This began her long-standing commitment and leadership to teacher education and teacher education research. She has a long list of contributions, teacher education, ministerial appointments, president of the Teacher Education of New South Wales, founding member of the New South Wales Institute of Teachers' initial teacher education. She was, of course, also president of ATEA, the Australia Teacher Education Association, between 23 and 4, and was nominated as a fellow in 2017. In between time, she managed to fit in being co-editor of the Asia Pacific Journal of Teacher Education. As we all know, her contributions to AARE have been enormous. From 2005 to 8, she was chair of the Doctoral Thesis Committee, and was the first two-year term of president from 2009 and 10, and that was a really sensible decision. It makes the role of being a president, I think, one that actually becomes much more focused, but also, I would say, even enjoyable. She actually profiled AARE nationally and internationally. She is a highly respected colleague, and one could say a much loved member of the education academic community and also by her staff at CSU. She brings a democratic approach to all her different roles and is particularly active in her support to those new academics without compromising high expectations of people's performance, whether this is in research, governance or teaching. It's my pleasure to present to Jo her Honorary Life Membership.
Wow. I feel like I must be getting very old. But Julianne, thank you so much for those kind words, and thank you to your committee for honouring me in this way today. It's lovely to actually be able to walk out the front and see so many faces that are blasts from the past and people that I've known for so long. And it's also lovely to be able to see so many faces I've never seen before. And that is fantastic for AARE. I want to thank very briefly just a few people who've epitomised for me what AARE is and does. And I think a few years ago when Bob Lingard and Trevor Gale published their book Research by Association, I think they actually captured the idea of who we are as a research community in Australia. And I love the way that AARE has for years and years and continues to make sure that new members, new researchers coming into this fold are supported. If you're here for the first time and you only have three people at your session, know that everybody else has started it that way. And that we've all gone through the learning to be a researcher. That is what AARE provides for us, I believe. We learn how to research in other places, but how to be a researcher and how to be part of this community is what I have certainly learned here. I learned it from the very first day when Mari Brennan, my supervisor, said, off you go to AARE. And I think Mari and two other people were the only people that came to listen to what I had to say. And it is lovely to know that over the years, more and more people, you get to know more people, you get to network, and you find people who share with you the commitment to making education better. I want to thank Debbie Cunningham in particular. I stood up there a few years ago and offered her an award for life membership, and I know how much the work of this association depends on the very hard work that people put in. David was just talking about how in Singapore, effort and hard work is seen to produce achievement. Well, at AARE, effort and hard work does achieve achievement, and it's the effort and hard work of the executive members. To the current executive, to members of the executive from the past and the future, I do thank you very, very sincerely. I want to thank Jan Wright, without whose push and initiative I don't think this association would be where it is at the moment. I particularly want to thank Bill Green, who sometimes he says he's probably the highest paid research assistant in the business. And it's true for his generosity in sharing and inspiring us all to keep talking to each other. And in closing, I just wanted to say to the newcomers here, the benefits of membership are just so satisfactory, I suppose, that you get so much out of this association that I do wish you all the very best for the rest of your life as members, and I will continue to be part of AARE as long as I can. Thank you very much.
Congratulations, Jo. That's such a well-deserved award, and for everything you've done for the association as well. Just a few quick housekeeping. Just with the program at a glance, the program's in the booklet's correct, but there's just one little error in the program at a glance. So you just need to move it up half an hour. So lunch will be 12:30 to 1:30. Okay. And some highlights for today include all of your presentations, of course. The lunch SIG conveners meeting. So all the SIG conveners. So let's see where are you? Hands up, SIG conveners. And thank you for all of your hard work that you've been doing through the conference. Then we'll have the AARE presidential address from 1:30 until 3 o'clock. But within that time slot as well, we'll have the Betty Watts Indigenous Researcher Award and the AARE Postgraduate Student Researcher Award. And then this afternoon, some more presentations, and then come along tonight to the book launches. There'll be three books launched. Very exciting. I heard there's alcohol, so judging from last night, people will be really happy about that. And we just have a couple of minutes, and I just wondered if someone from NZARE might like to come up and just explain the significance of this beautiful object here. For the conference. You may have noticed this sitting here. It's come over especially for the conference, and it's really important to our New Zealand delegation. Oh, it's the lovely Cheryl Stevens. Let's make her welcome.
Thanks so much, Cheryl.
Thank you. Tēnā tātou katoa. The Māori that you see placed here was donated by one of our conference committees in 2006. as a significant contribution around collaboration. That conference occurred in Rotorua at that time, and it was from that committee a contribution in terms of educational research that began this journey of this Māori to where it is in Australia. And this is the first time it's travelled internationally. The biosecurity tested us. And we've got another story from our president, and we'll leave that for another award process. But the Māori is significant for this conference in particular because it's around the collaboration between AARE and NZARE and the many SIGs, caucuses, groups of collaboration that have already started and yet to continue. And this is our contribution to the conference committee, which Margaret has been leading, and my colleague Jenny Ritchie and I have been on that committee and had the privilege to participate by teleconference most times with a very excited and energised group. And I think that's a significant contribution that Margaret and her team have made as part of that collaboration. And I want everybody to give them a hand in terms of that work. So the Māori is about, in 2013, our colleagues in New Zealand held the Māori in Otago, in Dunedin, and that Māori has come from Dunedin, the South Island, to here to add from what occurred in Otago and Dunedin to this conference. This conference will then add further knowledge around educational research to when we take it home after Thursday to the next conference in New Zealand. And we want that contribution to also disseminate to Fremantle, I understand, for the conference for AARE next year. That's the significance of that. And you're welcome to come and touch it in terms of passing on the meaningful contribution that you make to this conference, but also the significance of the Māori for the conference. Kia ora.
Thank you so much, Cheryl. That was a wonderful description for us. Okay, now to commence the Circle of Life, morning tea's ready. So just upstairs where you were for the reception. Thank you very much, everyone.